JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's Daily Market Review for May the 5th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, Senior Market Analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar reversed and traded lower against most of the other G10 currencies on Monday and during the Asian session Tuesday. It gained slightly only against the euro and the Swiss franc. The main gainers were NOK, Aussie, SEK and Kiwi in that order, while the currencies against which the greenback lost the least ground were the pound and the Japanese yen. Now, the relative weakness of the dollar and the other safe havens, franc and yen, combined with the strengthening of the risk-linked Aussie and Kiwi, suggests that market sentiment rebounded again at some point during the day. After an extended weekend, due to Friday's holiday, most major EU indices tumbled more than 3%, perhaps due to tensions over the US-China trade saga flaring up again. Remember that on Friday, US President Trump said that China could have contained the virus and threatened that he could use tariffs to respond to China, and that if they don't buy US goods, the US will end the trade deal. He and his State Secretary Mike Pompeo accused the world's second largest economy of covering up the release of the virus from a laboratory in Wuhan. Wall Street opened lower as well and continued drifting south at the start of the session, but rebounded later with all three of its main indices finishing their trading in the green. The recovery was mainly aided by a rebound in technology stocks, with Nasdaq gaining 1.23%. The positive sentiment rolled over into the Asian session as well, with Hong Kong's Hang Seng gaining 0.67%. Japanese, Chinese and South Korea's markets were closed due to holidays. It seems that following the spark of new US-China tensions, investors may have turned their gaze back to the easing of the stay-at-home measures adopted due to the fast spreading of the coronavirus. Yesterday, New York governor announced a phased reopening of businesses, while his Californian colleague said that the reopening could start as early as this week. What may have also helped investors' appetite may have been the slowdown in both infected cases and deaths from the coronavirus, although deaths accelerated somewhat on Monday. They have already slowed notably over the weekend, and you can see it on the graph here. And all this brightens the green light for governments around the globe to continue easing their restrictions. Now, as for our view, we stick to our guns that the combination of stimulative measures by governments and central banks and the prospect of a vaccine being ready for distribution soon makes us more trustful over another round of recovery in equities and other risk-linked assets. However, one condition for this to materialize is no new negative headlines surrounding the US-China trade saga. Apart from that, another risk may be lifting the restrictive measures too quickly, which may result in the coronavirus to start spreading at an exponential pace again. We believe that this has to be a slow process, otherwise it may not take long before we are back to square one. Now, apart from news and headlines surrounding the coronavirus and the US-China sequels, we also had an RBA monetary policy decision overnight. As was widely anticipated, the bank kept its cash rate and the target of its three-year government bond yields at 0.25%. Officials said that they have scaled back the size and the frequency of their bond purchases, but they added that they are prepared to scale up these purchases again if deemed necessary. The Aussie barely reacted at the time of the announcement, perhaps as this was the expected outcome. Overall, though, the currency could stay supported if the broader market sentiment rebounds again on optimism surrounding the easing of the coronavirus. The commodity-linked currency may well outperform the safe havens, dollar, yen and franc, but it could also win the battle against its neighboring kiwi. Although a commodity-linked currency as well, the New Zealand dollar may underperform the Aussie due to monetary policy divergence. While the RBA has started scaling back its QE purchases, the RBNZ is expected to double its QE pace this month, at least according to Westpac, and also to cut interest rates to minus 0.5% in November, a move that could be telegraphed as early as in August. Remember that the RBA noted that at 0.25% plus 0.25%, interest rates in Australia have hit their effective lower bound. Now, as for the rest of today's events, during the European morning, Sweden's GDP for the first quarter is due to be released, but no forecast is currently available. At last week's gathering, the Riksbank policymakers decided to leave the repo rate unchanged at 0% and to continue their purchases of government and mortgage bonds up to the end of September 2020. They noted that they cannot rule out the possibility of interest rates being cut at a later date, but they added that it was not deemed justified at this point to increase demand by a cut. Given the fast spreading of the coronavirus outside China during the last month of the quarter, we wouldn't be surprised if we get a negative print. So the question may be how deep the economic wounds have been. Following just a downtick in the core CPIF rate for the month of March, a not that bad number may allow Riksbank policymakers to stay sidelined for a while more. On the other hand, a deep contraction may raise speculation that policymakers could take interest rates back into the negative territory soon. From the UK, we get the construction PMI for April, which is expected to have rebounded to 44 from 39.3, as well as the final services and composite PMIs, which are expected to confirm their preliminary estimates of 12.3 and 12.9 respectively. Later in the day, we get more final PMIs for April, this time from the US. The services and composite indices are due to be released, but similarly to the UK ones, they are anticipated to confirm their initial forecasts. Market participants may pay more attention to the ISM non-manufacturing PMI for the month, which is expected to have declined to 44 from 52.5. The US and Canadian trade data are also coming out. With regards to the energy market, the American Petroleum Institute's weekly report on crude oil inventories is coming out, but as it is always the case, no forecast is available. As for tonight, during the Asian morning Wednesday, it's another holiday in Japan, and thus Japanese markets will stay closed. In New Zealand, the employment report for the first quarter is coming out. The unemployment rate is expected to have increased to 4.3% from 4%, while the net change in employment is forecast to show that the economy lost 0.3% jobs after a stagnation in the last 3 months of 2019. The labor costs index is anticipated to have ticked up to 2.5% from 2.4%. A soft employment report may add more credence to the view of further easing by the RBNZ and perhaps hurt the kiwi. Australia's retail sales for the first quarter and China's Kaijin Services PMI for April are also due out. Australian retail sales are expected to have accelerated to 1.7% from 0.5%, while no forecast is available for China's Kaijin Index. That said, bearing in mind that the official non-manufacturing PMI of China rose to 53.2 from 52.3, we see the case for the Kaijin Index to have moved in a similar fashion. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 a.m. GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.